delighted, a little bit intimidated to see so many of you. I don't know why so many people would pitch up to listen to a story about feminist publishing, but I'm glad you're here. Okay, so what I'm going to do is talk about basically my journey as a feminist publisher and what has happened through that to trace what's happened in the world of publishing in India and what we might be looking at in the future. I started in publishing almost, well, pretty much 40 years ago, almost to the day. I remember that it was in August, and it was sometime in around 73 or 72, 73 formally. I think it might have been the 7th of August. So, what is this? Is it the 7th today? So we are pretty close to it. My entry into publishing was actually pretty accidental. I was playing table tennis with a friend of mine after a French class that we were attending and that we had joined because the French teacher was very handsome and because all the CD cafes in which you could hang out were in and around that area, which was called South Extension. So we were playing table tennis and I was complaining to her that in this thriving, bustling city of Delhi, I wanted to do something different from my life, from what was expected of me. And what was expected of me was that I would become a teacher of English literature because that is what I had studied. And I was feeling that Spencer and Milton, much though I loved them, bore no relation to my life and what was happening with it at the time. So this friend of mine said, why don't you come to my office and see, there might be a job there or there might be some freelance work there and you can see if you like it and then we can take it from there. And I thought her suggestion was completely brilliant and so I took that up. Now publishing in those days was a very, very different world from what you know today. In Delhi, much of publishing, mainstream publishing in English was concentrated in Delhi. Many publishing houses had moved to Delhi to be closer to the center of power. Most publishing houses were located on two roads in Delhi, one called Asaf Ali Road, which was a longish stretch, and another one called Ansari Road, which was a smaller stretch enclosed behind the wall of Purani Delhi. And at lunchtime in those streets, various people who worked in publishing houses would come out to eat the post-lunch paan or to have lunch over there or to eat some gulab jamuns or some such thing. They were all men. And what you would see at that time were these tailors which would come in because many publishing houses had their go-downs underneath their offices. So books and paper were being delivered on carts pulled by poor men or pulled by animals and they would draw up to the doors of publishing houses and these would be loaded and put into the publishing house downstairs. Also around that whole area in Daryaganj and in parts of old Delhi which touched on Daryaganj were all the services that you needed for publishing because all the services had to be bought in. So people who made blocks, you know, pictures were printed from blocks, like the blocks that are used for printing on cloth, except that these were made of metal. And people who were doing typesetting, and typesetting was done, those days there were no computers, so typesetting was done with metal, either molten metal, which was called hot metal typesetting, or already created letters, which was called cold metal typesetting. So all these services were in and around that area. And a point-to-point system of rickshaws had come up where you could go from one to the other to buy the services. When I entered my first publishing job, I was 21 years old. I had just finished my MA. So now it's 40 years later, so you can calculate my age quite easily from that. And I was appointed for a four-month stint in a very, very inglorious role. I joined the Oxford University Press, which was at that time functioning in India as a branch of Oxford University, as one of the few foreign publishing houses that were still there in India at the time. And what they were doing was they were adapting foreign textbooks for use in Indian schools. Because by the early 70s, the impact or the effects of long years of colonial domination of publishing were still there. So even though India, after independence, had begun to Indianize, and foreign businesses were asked to leave so that Indian businesses could grow, and if they stayed on, they could only have a 49% maximum shareholding. Even so, it was not so easy to transform textbooks overnight. So it was taking quite a lot of time for British textbooks to be ousted, for the mindset that people have that British is better, and for Indian textbook writers to develop their writing skills and to write textbooks. So we were in the process of Indianizing not only the content, but also the personnel who worked in publishing. So expatriate bosses who were all Angrezes had been asked to leave, but everybody didn't leave at the same time. They left gradually over a period of time. So my job, I was called a paster upper. And what I was doing was that these English books, these were called Active English, and they were created for British schools. So every child was called John and Mary or such like. And my job was to change John and Mary to Ram and Sita, so that these books could be useful for Indian schools. Now, our imaginations were at that time very limited. We functioned in a world very different from the world today. You can imagine what would happen today if books were had Ram and Sita just as versions of Indian names. But at that time, nobody thought of these things. So my job was to, there was a typesetter nearby. And the typesetter would take an RAM, put ink on it, and print it on a piece of shiny art paper several times over, and similarly Sita. And then I would get this art paper, and I used to have a blade with which I would cut it and paste it over Ram and Sita, over John and Mary. So I had to do a little bit of juggling with Ram, because Ram has only three letters and John has four. And I used to use something called rubber solution, which is also used for bicycle tires. So I became very familiar with bicycle shops, even though I never learned how to cycle. But in Delhi, I would go off to the bicycle shops to buy dabbas of rubber solution to use on this thing. There were two of us working at the time. I was the paster-upper, and the Oxford University Press employed an artist called Dean Gasper, who was from the northeast of India, and whose job it was to color blue eyes black, to make blonde hair black, and wait for it, to cut off the tops of double-decker buses. Because other than in Bombay, there were no double-decker buses around. So Dean Gasper used to take whitening solution, cut off the tops of double-decker buses, paste paper on it, and make blue eyes black and so on. And I was the paster-upper. So that was the beginning of my love affair with publishing, and a love affair which has lasted to this day. You know, a lot of people who do glue sniffing sniff rubber solution. The smell of rubber solution used to make me high, but not because I was glue sniffing, but just for the reason that I was so in love with the whole activity of publishing. My dream had been to be a printer. And I wanted to have a small printing press on a desk like this in my house, and to print political pamphlets for all my friends who were getting involved in politics, or getting involved in political movements, not politics. But of course, that didn't happen. So the next best thing was publishing. So I started working in the Oxford University Press, and then I stayed there for several years, learning different aspects of the job. The publishing scene, as I've explained to you at that time, was very different from what it is today. Not only was it different in terms of the content it published, but also various other things. For example, let's say much of the publishing, 80% of the publishing that was happening in India was publishing of textbooks for educational use. The kind of books that you and I might read for pleasure or entertainment, etc., hardly existed. The Indian government had taken some steps which were very enlightened to ensure that knowledge flowed freely. So while they had put restrictions on everything else that you could import, there were no real restrictions on books. So as individuals, you or I could, at a time when India did not have a lot of foreign exchange, if we wanted to buy books from abroad, we could order them and the Reserve Bank would give us any amount of foreign exchange in exchange for our rupees. The principle was that knowledge should be freely available and people need knowledge to improve their minds, etc. However, there was also the fact that India had become independent and we needed to develop Indian publishing, which had up until now been dominated by colonial publishers. And in order to encourage Indian publishing to develop, restrictions were put on imports of books by publishers, imports in bulk. So there were some rules which said you could not import more than 1,000 copies of a certain book in a calendar year and so on. But you know, us Indians are very clever. We know how to get around everything. And money is God. So what many publishers, unscrupulous publishers, would do would be to set up 5 different companies and import 5,000 copies of the same book, 1,000 under each company name, and import them at the end of the financial year, and then do the same thing at the beginning of the financial year, so you would have 10,000 copies. So every time you went out to look for books, you found a whole lot of rubbish and the junk that Western countries wanted to get rid of, which was sent into India in large quantities. And although, because we did not have bookshops of the kind that we do today, most of these books ended up on the pavement. So I also remember buying most of my books in pavement stores across Delhi, and most of them tended to be a very low order of reading, Harold Robbins, Mills and Boone, and such like.